each Advent season, in our circles of light to listen, to share the story once again, and what a story it is. How many stories do you know that are over 2,000 years old? How many stories do you know that mean as much to you as this one does? Do you feel as personally close to anyone else in history as you do to Mary and Joseph? How many other Roman rulers can you name besides Caesar Augustus? Even those nameless shepherds seem so familiar to us. Of course they do. For as long as we can remember, we have joined them, watching their flocks, hearing the angels, and kneeling at the manger. Light shines and darkness does not overcome it. The Bible says it is certainly true of the manger we hear again in this holy season. The years have not dimmed its glory. On the contrary, the passing of time seems to make the story shine even more brightly. The expanding circles of light. Like the stories that grandparents tell, there is something here that is worth hearing, worth keeping, worth remembering, worth sharing. Listen, precisely because you know it so well. I love to tell the story of the unseen things above, of Jesus and his glory, of Jesus and his love. I love to tell the story because I know it's true. It satisfies my longing as nothing else would do.
Words of Micah. But you, O Bethlehem of Ephrathah, who are one of the little clans of Judah, from you shall come forth for me one who is to rule in Israel. Micah 5:2. Although tiny Bethlehem was a city with a proud history, the city of David, It was still tiny, not the kind of place where you would expect lightning to strike twice. Not a location to inspire a second candle to shine forth. One glimpse of glory should be all the place deserved. Yet, inspired by God, the prophet Micah had foreseen a ruler coming, once again from David's tiny town. And in that coming, the promise of peace in all its fullness, the kind of peace the very angels of the Lord would proclaim on those same sheep-filled hills, surrounded by light. And even more light would be evident. Micah's ancient words would guide those strangers from afar, the wise men, to the place where the Christ child lay. Candlelight reflected in starlight, even in such an unlikely place as Bethlehem. The circles widened. O little town of Bethlehem, how still we see thee lie. Above thy deep and dreamless sleep, the silent stars go by. Yet in thy dark streets shineth the everlasting light. The hopes and fears of all the years are met in thee tonight. Merry Christmas from our family to yours.
Sunday, we learned of the shepherds. In Luke 2, 8 to 12, it reads, "In the same country, there were shepherds in the fields. They were watching their flocks of sheep at night. The angel of the Lord came to them. The shining greatness of the Lord shone around them. They were very much afraid. The angel told them, 'Do not be afraid. See, I bring you good news of great joy, which is for all people. Today, one who saves from the punishment of sin has been born in the city of David. He is Christ the Lord. These will be something special for you to see. This is the way you and I know him. You will find the baby with cloth around him, lying in a place where cattle are fed.'" And then in Luke 2, 17 and 18, it continues, "When they saw the child, they told what the angel said about him. All who heard it were surprised at what the shepherds told them. He has brought down the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the lowly." Luke 1:52. Why did God choose to have the message of the Savior's birth come first to the shepherds, of all people? Why not the mayor of Bethlehem, or town council, the village rabbi, a prominent businessman? Why shepherds of all people? Was it because other people were too busy or preoccupied to listen? Can that happen to us too? Was it because the way God was doing things was not the way they would have? Can that happen to us too? Or had others actually turned their backs and purposely ignored the gift that God was giving? Can that happen to us too? Was the stable setting too humble for more refined folks to visit? Can we express that attitude too? Or was it just to let us know that everyone is welcome? The shepherd's candle glows brightly enough to assure us that there is none too poor, too lowly, too dirty, too humble, too despised to be excluded from God's circle of light. But humble is the way to come. Your little ones, dear Lord, are we, and come your lowly bed to see. Enlighten every soul and mind, that we the way to you may find.
Of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among men, with whom he is pleased."
Thank you. message comes to its climax. God himself has come among us, just as prophets had promised in God's faithful word. God has come among us to fulfill a wondrous function, as priests and kings had been anointed through the years. In that function, a savior, the angel announces, just as Mary had rejoiced, my spirit rejoices in God my savior. Just as Joseph had been told, name him Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. Remember, Christ our Savior was born on Christmas Day, a familiar carol reminds us. A carol that goes on to sing about the message of the angels and concludes each chorus with, O tidings of comfort and joy. Indeed, our circles of light have been lit week by week to bring the Savior into ever sharper view and to let the message of his wondrous love grow brighter and still brighter yet.
Silent night, holy night, all is calm, all is bright, round yon virgin mother and child. Jesus, Lord.